And so yate, good evening everybody. Thank you for coming to this graduate school workshop. She'eya Sara Kien in Shia. Hotsuik as Canada Nishlit and Divk as Canada Bashishin. The Beh Hotsui Scotland Dashache Ado Belagana Bete England Dashinale. Kut ego eya Belagana as Zan Nishlit. I always say it only took me taking Navajo 101 three times to get to that point. So Pat and my husband, many hours of patient practicing with my husband. Now I can say that, and I can say Yadela, and I can say Mose. Okay. So, thank you for being here. This is a graduate school workshop. Specifically for the psychology BA program, but it applies to a lot of different graduate programs. And it's really just an information session. It's an informal information session. So, and basically I'm just gonna try to throw as much information at you as I can within a short period of time. And a lot of it is just gonna be planting seeds, giving you ideas about what graduate school is, what the purpose of it is, what are different types of programs, how do you apply, how do you prepare for graduate school? What's it like? And we'll also have a Q&A, and I have a ton of handouts. And for those of you who are not able to join us because you're snowed in somewhere or because you're at different campuses, good evening. We are video recording it, and we're going to be posting it on YouTube. So if you didn't catch something I said, you can also go back and replay. Well, if you just love watching me, but don't be creepy about it, okay? Just be normal. So... like I said, it's going to be informal. And let me just kick it off by asking a question. How many of you, and you're going to be like, what? Is this where we're starting? But how many of you have heard of graduate school before? Just raise your hand if you've heard of graduate school before.
Right.
Yeah, if you've heard of graduate school before, then you're already way ahead of where I was when I was sitting in your seat. It wasn't until towards the end of my third year in graduate school that I even heard the term graduate school. I'm serious. I had not even heard that term before. I didn't even know what it was. The first time somebody asked me about graduate school, I was like, what? I don't understand what you're talking about. So if I can do it, you can do it. You're already way ahead of me, all right? You're already way ahead of where I was when I was in your shoes. And so... graduate school is an opportunity to pursue a master's degree, right, or a PhD. And we're going to talk about the difference between a master's degree and a PhD. And why would you want to pursue a master's degree instead of a PhD, or a PhD instead of a master's degree? So we're going to go over some of that. And if you have questions at any point, because part of the reason we wanted to video record this, hi, good evening. Part of the reason we wanted to video record this was so that anybody who was watching could also hear the questions that you have. So I try to anticipate as much as I can what you guys are wanting to know, but please, even though there'll be a Q&A session at the end, at any point, if you're like, wait, what? Stop, what are you talking about? Just put your hand up, okay? Or just yell at me, hey, all right? I'll respond. This is what we're gonna cover today: introductions, why go to graduate school, what is it, finding the right program, the application process, examples of programs. And then we're very honored to have multiple individuals in this room who either have completed graduate degrees or even are in the process of pursuing their graduate degree. Levine Blackmountain is here. She is a disability coordinator over at Student Success. She has a master's degree in counseling. She was also on, I catch her in the middle of taking a bite. She was on the advisory council for developing the psychology BA program. So she played an instrumental and foundational role in developing the psychology BA program. We also have Dr. Christine Ami and her husband Carlin. So Christine just recently graduated with her PhD, so like give it up for Dr. Ami. And some of this will probably be like triggers for her, and it'll bring back some trauma that she experienced through graduate school, but you know, she has a lot of experience, and she is amazing, so she has a lot that she can share with you. We also have Dr. Bruce Bradway with us here tonight, and so he's So Dr. Bradway also completed his PhD in psychology. And what's really cool about Dr. Bradway and Levine Black Mountain and myself is that we all have degrees, graduate degrees in psychology, but we have very different experiences and different types of graduate degrees in psychology. So we're able to offer like a breadth of experience, diverse experiences. So we'll have an opportunity for us to share our personal experiences. And for me, like I said, I didn't even hear about graduate school. But I went on to pursue a master's degree and then a PhD, and here I am, right? Now I get to stand in front of you fine folks. So what's the purpose of going to graduate school? You know, it seems like a no-brainer to go to graduate school, but it only seems that way because people bring it up a lot, right? They're probably already, you just are in the middle of your bachelor degree program. Some of you just got admitted, like even just days ago, like yesterday, right? To the day before yesterday, got admitted into the psychology BA program. Yay. People are probably, yeah, we have like over 50, I think it's close to 55 students enrolled in the program that just started this fall. It's like the most popular program in the history of Diné College. And we didn't expect this. I was hoping for 10 students. So it's, people are really excited about it. And you're probably already getting questions like, well, what are you going to do out? Are you going to go to graduate school? People are probably already asking some of you those questions. And so it seems like it's an obvious next step, but why? What's the advantage of it? And you have to kind of look at what is involved in graduate school and what the purpose of it is, what the advantage is, and weigh the trade-off. So it definitely opens up a new world in your area of interest. If you're in higher education because you love learning and you're passionate about learning, then graduate school might be the place for you. For me, I don't even think I ever weighed the pros and cons about going to graduate school. I just wanted to keep going. And look it, I'm still here, right? I'm still in higher ed. I love higher education. I'm very passionate about it. I love learning. I love psychology. I wanted to learn everything I could about psychology. And I'm very interested in psychology. And in particular, in cognitive and cultural psychology. I recently became very interested in counseling psychology. So it helps you really pursue your interest and what you're passionate about. And I know many of you, just from meeting you and talking to you one-on-one, I know how passionate you are, each of you already, about your learning and about your education. It helps you to keep up with advances in the field. It really helps you to stay like on the cutting edge, you know. I learned how to learn in graduate school. So I continue pursuing all of the most recent research that's being conducted, and I'm able to bring that into the classroom. And I love learning about those things. It broadens and expands your intellectual horizons. It helps with a career change. And frankly, it just helps you to pursue additional opportunities in diverse careers and diverse fields. Actually, the correct way to describe it is it kicks down doors of opportunity. I mean, seriously. It just like busts down doors of opportunity. Even here at Diné College, the difference in a faculty member, the difference between a faculty member who has a master's degree and a PhD, for example, is a difference of approximately $10,000 at least. And so it actually helps to increase your salary even in the same kind of career choice. So in addition to having more options for careers, you have more options for higher salary. It allows you to teach in a college and university, if that's your thing. Okay, I love it. I love teaching. I still get really nervous before I teach. Even after like 15 years, I get really nervous. But I love it. I'm very excited to be teaching. I love being in the classroom. It allows entry to professional jobs that require a graduate degree. On the information and orientation packet for the Psychology BA program that's posted on our Social Behavioral Sciences website, you'll see two columns. You'll see a list of jobs that are available for students who have a bachelor degree or individuals who have a bachelor degree in psychology. And at any given time, there's between like 20 and 40 jobs available, specifically calling for somebody who has a bachelor degree in psychology. But there's another column. And those columns are for jobs that are specifically asking for individuals who have graduate degrees in psychology. And if you have a graduate degree in psychology, all of those options are available to you. And most of them involve working with people, working, in the case of psychology, working with community, making a difference, supporting psychological well-being. And I know that's why many of you are choosing the Psychology BA program, because that's what you want to do. You want to make a difference. when you have that many more opportunities to make a difference. You can earn more money in promotion. Cha-ching, right? Who doesn't like more money? More money, more problems, right? Not really, no. More money, more money. And you're less likely to be unemployed, okay? So, like I say, it really does kick down doors of opportunity. I'm speaking from experience. I have a PhD. I don't worry about whether I'm going to have a job or not. I don't worry about that. When you have a graduate degree, you have more options. So even if Diné College, or maybe Diné College will decide one day that they don't want me here anymore. That's okay though. I mean, I'll be devastated. Well, I do. But it's okay. I'll find something. Because I know I have experience and I have an educational background, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's really about like freedom of choice. And that way I know that I'm here because I choose to be here. Not because I have to be here, because I can't find any other job, right? And psychologically speaking, that's important. Research shows that people are more fulfilled and more satisfied with their lives if they are internally motivated to do what they do. And I talk about this a lot in the classes that I teach. But if they're externally or extrinsically motivated simply by like pressure, external pressure, like because I have to be here, because I need money, if those are the primary motivational factors, you're less satisfied in the work you do. If you feel like you're here because you choose to be here and you want to be here in this job, you're happier in your job, you're happier in your life, all right? So these things matter. What's it like? What is graduate school like? Well, so we could like stop right here, right? Like, do I have to convince you to go to graduate school? Like we're all in, right? And you should be. And guess what? You can do it. So we're even gonna push past these next slides. The next slides are gonna be like, what? Do I really wanna do this? But yes, you can do it, okay? So what is graduate school like? I found this. Grad school is easy. It's like riding a bike, except the bike is on fire and you're on fire and everything is on fire and you're in hell, okay? Is this true? Kind of. It's kind of true. It's not entirely true. There are times when you can feel like when you're in graduate school, like it's not gonna happen. In fact, I know some of you have come and talked to me while you're pursuing your psychology BA degree. You've got many responsibilities. You have family to take care of, right? You've got a job. I did too when I was an undergrad. I was working like almost, I didn't have a family, it was just me. A little old me, now it's me and that guy. That's my husband, that video people out there. Okay, I'm pointing to my husband. And my dogs, of course. But, you know, I don't have a family, and that's a huge responsibility, right? That's a huge responsibility. I was working almost full-time, though, and I took out student loans. I had no money. I was broke. And I remember what it's like. And so I know some of you already in your bachelor's degree program, sometimes it feels like it's touch and go, right? Like one person described it to me once, a student in the BA program. It's like you're juggling something on this hand, and you've got something on your hand, and you've got something on your foot. You're kind of juggling multiple things at once, right? Especially if you're working, you have family, and you're enrolled in college. And it feels like that way in graduate school, too. And graduate school kind of kicks it up a notch. But guess what? By the time you get to graduate school, you've already completed an entire degree. That degree prepares you for graduate school. So you'll hear people talk about it being a lot of work, and it is, but you can do it. By the time you get to that point, you are ready. You have a lot of study skills and work habits and work ethic and self-discipline that you've acquired throughout your bachelor's degree to be able to continue taking on that challenge. So it's harder, but by the time you get there, you're ready for it, okay? You're ready for it. So that's what I mean, you can do it. And why is it harder? The classes, we can talk about this when we talk about different kinds of graduate programs, but a lot of times the expectations for the academic standards are a little bit higher. Mm-hmm. In many schools, you can only get a certain number of B's before mm-hmm. you're expelled from the school, right? So the academic standards are higher. No C's. Nope. A's. All A's. That's what they expect of you. Or they will thank you for your time. And ask you to step outside, yeah. Or you don't have to just step outside and stand there. You can step outside and apply for a different graduate program. But you guys, if everybody's in here, and like our psychology BA program, I was saying we have 55 students who are enrolled in the program. And I remember, like, people were wondering, are students ready for BA programs, for bachelor programs here at Diné College? The students in the BA program in psychology are, like, top notch. You know, many of you are performing at a really high level. So getting A's and B's in graduate school is going to be a piece of cake for you guys. All you have to do, and really if you think about it, it's not something that you're not capable of. All you have to do is put in the work. That's it. And that's what everything's about, right? With family, what do you have to do? Show up, right? Put in the work. With school, what do you have to do? Show up, put in the work. With work, you just show up, put in, all you have to do is put in the work. And you can do that, right? So it's academically demanding. It'll be stressful, more stressful, if you don't know why you're there. And if you're there for the wrong reasons, okay? If you're there because you feel like this is what you're supposed to do, because people told you that this is what you're supposed to do next, it's not gonna work. You have to really want to be there. And then if you want to be there, it's exciting. You know, those 10-page, 15-page papers, they're difficult, but you are excited about what you're writing about, right? You're learning, you're developing those skills. So you have to make that decision for the right reason. You have to know why you're going. It's necessary for some professions, right? So definitely, if you are interested in pursuing counseling, you'll need a graduate degree. You'll need a master's degree. If you're interested in becoming a professor, because you're so inspired by the amazing professors here at Diné College, you'll need a graduate degree to do it. If you are interested in doing research, and I know some of you even are, even after taking my research methods class and my stats class, you're still interested in research, you'll need a graduate degree to do that. If you want to become a school counselor, and what is that? We'll talk about that, the difference between a school counselor and other kinds of counseling and a research career. But you'll need a graduate degree. So there's a lot you can do with a bachelor's degree in psychology, but there's a lot, if you really want to pursue that kind of field, those kinds of fields that I just mentioned, you really want a graduate degree. So make sure you know why you're doing it. If you're doing it for a particular profession, make sure you know why you're choosing that profession, right? Focus on your area of interest, and it requires a lot more study time. So there's kind of like these trade-offs, right? It requires more study time, but you're just completely immersed in something that you're passionate about. Why? Because you made the right decision, right? You know why you're there. This job at Diné College sometimes is overwhelming for me because it's a lot of work. I do a lot of work. But I never get completely overwhelmed because I know why I'm here. I know why I'm here. It's really easy for me to remind myself why I'm here. I'm here because of you. I'm here for you. That's why I'm here. Super easy for me to remind myself why I'm here. All right. So, keys to getting into graduate school. I kind of thought maybe this would be a good time, especially if some people have made it through their meals, for us to share a little bit about our story, like why we pursued graduate school and what did it take for us to get into graduate school. And I want to kind of like push through a lot of this. I provided you with a handout with all these slides, and for video people, I'm going to send these handouts to everybody in the Psych BA program and to anybody else who would like them. But I wanted to like kind of make a personal connection here and to talk a little bit more about these different experiences we had. So for myself, when I pursued graduate school, like I said, I didn't even know what it was the first time that it was brought up to me. Then I attended a graduate school workshop, much like you're doing now, and I decided to go for it. I was like, I'm gonna go for it. And I did. And I worked really, 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 really hard. Once I realized I wanted to go to graduate school, I worked really, really hard. I started studying all the time. I started improving my grades. I volunteered I was in Canada. So I volunteered at the Canadian Mental Health Association. Volunteer work like that looks really good on an application to graduate school. I started hanging out with grad students. Actually, my very first graduate school workshop, the guy who gave the workshop was a graduate student. He was super cute, so I don't even remember anything I learned. That's the thing I remember the most about my graduate school workshop. And I still made it to graduate school, okay? So I doubt any of you are in that situation right now. So again, you're way ahead of me. You're actually like learning something. You're not like, oh. So when I started applying, I don't want to go through, like, there's a lot that I could say, but I want to talk about my approach, because I want to help give you kind of a perspective. graduate school programs are very competitive as well. They're very competitive. And everybody here is capable of achieving a graduate degree. Everybody here is. And everybody here is capable of being accepted into a graduate program. What does it take to get into a graduate program? A high GPA or a decent GPA. What does that mean? It depends on the program. So a decent GPA, a decent GRE, a GRE. We'll talk about what is the GRE. For the record, and this is on video, I hate the GRE, I hate it. It doesn't predict graduate school success. It's like a necessary evil. So we'll talk about what that is. And one of the reasons I wanted to hold this workshop now is because it's one of the things, if you're even thinking about graduate school, it's one of the things you need to start thinking about right now. Right now. Mm-hmm. So the GRE. And let's see, GPA, GRE. Some volunteer experience. All right. Doesn't have to be a lot. You know, if you're already really struggling, just a little bit. Even something here associated with student success, I think would be something, depending on how student success would want to work with volunteers. That could be something that's possible. Maybe volunteering at IHS. So we can talk about those kinds of opportunities. Having like strong research background, which is why we have so many, in any program, even a counseling program, it's why we have such a rigorous program and so many research courses, including advanced indigenous research course and independent research, undergraduate research project course in our psychology BA curriculum, because that's going to look good on your application for graduate school. A rigorous program with research experience, okay? So you'll get those opportunities here. But even if you had a 4.0 GPA and one of the top GRE scores and even like a bunch of research publications and all kinds of volunteer experience, you still may not get accepted into every graduate program. Why? Because graduate programs are competitive, and a lot of times the faculty who are going to be mentoring students in those graduate programs are looking for a particular student with a very particular interest that's just like one tiny piece of the entire field of psychology. And so how can you find your right match? We'll talk about that. But when I applied to graduate school, having been provided with that kind of information and that kind of advice, I did two things. And this is the approach I want you to think about. The first thing I did was I cast a wide net. I applied to a lot of different programs. And even if you want to stay in the area, there are a lot of opportunities to stay in Arizona, New Mexico area, and a lot of different programs you can apply to. So cast a wide net. But the other thing is, I had a backup plan just in case I didn't get in. And when I applied for my PhD, there were some schools who rejected me, even though I had a 4.0 GPA in my master's degree. And I had several publications by that point. And some schools rejected me because they were looking for something. But some schools accepted me. And by the time I got accepted, I was kind of disappointed, because I had this really elaborate, amazing backup plan just in case. I was gonna travel the world, I had planned it all out, I was gonna backpack across. I'm not saying you should do that if you don't need to do that. That was me, okay? And just know that just by being in the BA program, you're already accomplishing a lot, okay? Mm-hmm. So don't like hold up graduate school as like something that's going to determine for yourself your ability to contribute and make a difference, right? And another approach, another strategy is to just keep applying, all right? If it doesn't work out the first year, apply again, apply again. It's just a matter of time. It's just a matter of time, okay, trust me. Especially if you're working hard, doing well in your classes, studying for the GRE, all right, the GRE. And so for me, by the time I got accepted, I was kind of disappointed. When I got into graduate school, it was a huge like wake-up call. Because I had been doing really well as an undergrad once I realized I wanted to go to graduate school. And suddenly I was surrounded by a lot of people who were like way smarter than me. And it was intimidating. And it was hard to keep up. I had to like bust my ass. I had to work really, really hard. I had to work really, really hard. And hi, good evening. There's still some dinner there if you want to help yourself. And there's a bunch of handouts right over there. I worked really hard. I can't remember what I was going to say, but the end. I worked hard. Oh yeah, I worked really, really hard. But for me, it was still a big shock to be surrounded by so many people who are also working as hard. So at the undergraduate level, I was like doing pretty well. I was feeling like pretty good about myself. My head was like about 5 times larger than it is now. See how small it is? It's like abnormally small. Graduate school will do that. It will shrink your head. Seriously, like I can't even wear, I have to wear children's sunglasses. My head is so tiny now because of graduate school. Because there are a lot of smart people out there. And more importantly, what is intelligence? And some of you have taken some of my like intro psych classes and developmental, human growth and development class, you'll learn this. You know, we have different concepts of intelligence. And people who have a concept of intelligence in which they believe that it is something you can work towards and get better at, the harder you work, the smarter you'll be. Overall, they perform better academically than people who feel like intelligence is something you're born with. So all those people who are around me who are smarter than me, it's because they were working harder than me, and I didn't even think that was possible at the time. There are people who are always working harder, all right? And it's competitive like that, but you just keep trying, you cast a wide net, you don't give up, you stay positive, you have a backup plan, you can make a difference, all right? You're already gonna have your bachelor's degree in psychology, and there are a lot of opportunities to do important work here on the Navajo Nation with a bachelor's degree in psychology. And then by the time I was halfway through my graduate program, I just couldn't wait to get out. And I was super burnt out at the end, and it was a lot of work, but it's so worth it. It's so worth it. Like, I don't, as hard as it was, I really was burnt out at the end. I don't regret it at all, not at all. And I still say with 100% confidence, if you're thinking about doing it, go for it. It's a short-term investment for a long-term gain. When you're in it, just like every semester, right? At the beginning, you're all excited. Oh, I'm gonna learn about psychology. Halfway through, you're like, when is this gonna be over? It's like, you feel like you've been in it forever. You feel like it's forever until you get through. You can't even see the light at the end of the tunnel. But by the end of it, you look back and you're like, dang, that was fast, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, graduate school is the same. There's a point in graduate school. You just feel like it's never, ever, ever gonna end, but it does. All of a sudden, it ends, and you graduate, and you have your graduate degree, and that's what it's like. So that's my experience, and I pursued a research PhD. If you're interested in research, you should go for a PhD, and you can. And the nice thing about most PhD programs is that they'll fund you, and they'll pay for your tuition if they accept you. Some master's programs do that, but more PhD programs do that than master programs. So if you're at the point, and PhD programs are more competitive, but if you feel like you can get there, and if you research different programs, you'll see information about their acceptance rates, their average, the average GPA of people who are accepted into programs, the average GRE of people who are accepted into programs. If you feel like you're there for PhD programs, yes, go for it. It's a few years longer, just a few years. It kicks down more doors of opportunity, and in most programs, they'll pay for you, and they'll cover your tuition. And they'll give you a stipend, like a $25,000 stipend to live off of in psychology. In the field of psychology, that's how it works. Okay, even in like clinical, you can do clinical psychology research work and come out with a license and do counseling. You can be a counselor and a researcher. You could become a psychiatrist, so you could have an MD and a PhD in clinical psychology, which allows you to prescribe medication. That's what the MD part does. Mm-hmm. So for me, I pursued a research PhD, and I love it. I love research, and I love cognitive psychology, and that's, if you're gonna become a cognitive psychology, that's what you do, research. So it's a pretty, like, very strongly academic pathway that I took. But I'd like to invite, if she's ready, Levine Black Mountain up to come and talk about her experience. Is now a good time? Do you feel like, yeah, okay, come on up.
Good evening, everybody.
Good
evening. Shaya, Levine Black Mountain. She has other 28 inch. I got to know Sarah a year ago as she was the new psychology. And she brought us in. We were talking about developing the BA in psychology program. And one day we were just kicking it around. And one of the things that we did was thinking that we were going to roll it out until this fall. fall 17. That was our initial plan to roll up the BA psychology. And one of the things that we talked about for me was looking at Native, looking at the Najib and Ma'atkin, the Hishkin Sabah, the Khadid Diné. That was one of my things. I also recruited two of my colleagues who had their master's degree too. Latoy Harrison, who is a counselor over at Strip-Off. She has her master's in social work. And then I have Ms. Marcy Chi. She was here as a counselor. She also has, she's now in Strip-Off too. So the three of us, you know, work with Sarah. And since they were in Strip-Off, it became me being involved in the advisory. And it was a unique experience for me to participate back in May when the HLC, or was it March, that the HLC were here. To actually sit in on a review, and they asked us questions, and I thought, you know, I'm this being this Native woman, and you know, with the HLC committee, we had representatives that came in and asked us about the psychology program, and I guess it's a way of saying, you know, Sarah was our main chairperson for this program, but at the same time, they asked us. Even Dr. Wilson Obama was in there. Mm-hmm. And so that was a unique experience for me, to be part of such an elaborate group here. And so for me, my background is basically was in education first. My first master's was in 2003, and that was in special education. And I worked with K-12 school setting, the preschool, then the mentality was that children with special needs are the one with the behavior problems. And so there was an opportunity for me to say, my employer, if we pay for your tuition, would you go back to school for your counseling? And I jumped at it. And my interest to this day is early childhood mental health, the 0 to 5. If I leave here, that's one of the things that I would like. But then at the same time, we have this program, and you know, I'm kind of pulled towards that to teach some of these courses. And so I'm giving myself at least a year to, you know, really think about and start teaching some of these classes. Because when you talk K-12, and I'm thinking, you know, it's a challenge, and that's something that I look forward to. So going back to my counseling, I did my first clinical with behavioral health, which was substance abuse. Working with adolescent, young adults, and older adults. And that wasn't really what I wanted. And so then my second portion, my 180 hours of my clinical, I ended up doing with IHS. And they're in Chinle. If you can do a clinical or even volunteer work with IHS in the psychology, it's gonna be awesome. I think I've learned more there than I actually did with the other. And then again, that was still with the school setting too. That's what I did. So one of the things that I know, just like Ms. Sarah mentioned, is that it takes a lot. Sleepless nights. You're operating on 3-4 hours of sleep. And again, if you decide to go to graduate schools, and there are many schools. For me, coming born and raised here in Arizona, all of my education was done in New Mexico, just because of the small class size. And being Native, I'm the first in my generation to go to college, even get an AA degree in my family. And then doing my undergrad and then my master's program. And one of the things that I tell students is here, you know, we ask a lot of questions. What are you passionate about? That's one of the key things that I learned too along this journey. It's like, what are you passionate about? And for me, it's working with children, working with young adults, and then even, you know, our students here. And when you come across a student that's working really hard, you tend to take them under your wings when you start working with them and you help them. If you look at it this way, and I think us developing this BA program, that's basically what we said, is that they're going to be three tracks the MA in social work, the MA in counseling, and under counseling, there's two categories. You either go school counseling or clinical counseling. And then the MA in sociology as well. And that were the three tracks that we're looking at. And for my schooling, I work with Western New Mexico University in Gallup. Do you guys know where Alice Tanner Training goes us? Mm-hmm. Just right across. Just for me, it was convenient. It was close to home. We had classes from 5 to 9, and then Saturdays, 8 to 5. So I still could be a full-time employee taking care of my family, and then going to school, and that was where I went. So now, like I said, we're here, and being here for the past 3 years, and the past year working with the sociology, and I've got an opportunity to work with Christine as well, Dr. Omi, with on behalf of some of our students. And like I said, I work with the students with disabilities. And it's the advocacy work that we do here. And that's something that, you know, in your line of work, even though we're saying the BA psychology kind of interest, you know, start looking at you with the school setting, or is it the clinical, or is it substance abuse, that's where you're gonna see yourself. And in time, you know, you're just now starting, if this is your first semester, second semester, and those career interests will change. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, you guys, like, you know, Sara had mentioned, not many of us knew what graduate school was. And again, the GRE, that is something. And then also, you use that to get into graduate school. Not only that, but then you have three references. And I think those count more than the GRE itself. Mm-hmm. And then when you complete your program, like in special ed, in education, they call it the NTE, which is the National Teacher's Exam. You pass that and you get your license. Then the same thing with counseling. They call it the NCE, National Counseling Exam. And again, those are things that we have to go through. And even for the BA, I think those are the opportunities are there as well. So I think, you know, like we're saying, grown up in a traditional home with culture, language, and everything. You come full circle. That's what I learned in this graduate program. And it's something, again, like I said, you know, now we hear learning is a lifelong process, right? Every day we learn something, even from on here, you know. And one of the things that I in graduate school that I enjoy too is I like the group activity work. Because you learn more from each other that way. And so in here, in your BA program, if you guys have an opportunity to work in teams, take advantage of that, because that helps you even more. Going back and forth, for the past, from January through November, I also held a counseling position here. And the disability, it was very challenging. Mentally, it was exhausting, but I thought. School is the same. Work is the same. Mm-hmm. Although, like, if you look back at our elders, I thought, yeah, if they have livestock, it is exhausting. Every day you're out there. Just like you guys are here in Chiquilla. We're here, we made it to class. You know, give yourself a round of a hand for that. And that shows determination, dedication, commitment, and discipline on your part. So that's something that I hope, you know, you guys look at. I mean, my office is the Student Success Center. And if you guys have any questions, you know, feel free to talk to us. That's what, you know, Sara had mentioned, that we're here, you know, Haida. Sometimes that's what I tell all my students, all the students that we advise, if you have any questions, they'll be capable to know. Sometimes you hear it 2-3 times on a show, you know, that's something that. And again, Sarah mentioned PhD program. Just recently, I started looking at that. I looked at, you know, NAU, ASU, U of A, and I came back to my old undergrad, NMSU. And the title itself was what really jumped out at me, and it was called PhD in Clinical Psychology. If I were to go back, I think that's where I'll go. But not today, not tomorrow, somewhere in the near future, you know. So again, like I said, you know, you guys are here, and I'm very, you know, thankful to Sarah as well that, you know, we came together, and she was very open about, you know, how do we develop this program to where our native people, our Navajo culture, our Navajo language is infused in that. And that's the part where, you know, we play a role in. And I would like to thank you for that.
I hope you're getting a sense, what is a graduate program? It's an opportunity for increased specialization, right? To have increased expertise in your field, increased skills, right? And it's like step by step. You don't have to this is just planting seeds. You don't have to think about it all at once. You don't have to decide right now whether you're gonna go to graduate school. Like Levine's saying, now she's starting to look into PhD programs, right? And she knows one day. Okay, it's just step by step, right? You're planning, right? This is, what's the first one? Nahat'a? Ina? Sahake? That's the first one. Sahake? Ina? Nahat'a? Nahat'a second? Yeah, don't come to me for learning about Navajo culture, right? No, they're all there. But from the Belagana perspective, I understand some of that, right? Which is like planning and then living and doing it, right? And then it's step-by-step process. At the end, you get to look back and see what you accomplished and feel proud and reflect, right? Mm-hmm. And then take the next step. So I get the concept. I can't say it in Diné, but I have some kind of understanding. Mm-hmm. So that's what this is about. This is about just thinking about it, the thinking part, right? And then the planning, so thinking about it, okay? And the next step is planning, so not all at once. All right, so how do you get into graduate school? Now that you kind of have an idea of what it's about, right? How do you get in? Know what you want, start thinking about it. That's where, and start like imagining yourself, envisioning yourself in the future. What do you want to be doing in the future? What would you like to be doing? You don't have to decide right now. But this is like, it's kind of fun. You get to be creative about it right now, right? It's like inspire yourself, right? Find out about careers that you think might interest you. The field of psychology is huge. The difference between school counseling and clinical counseling, now we've brought that up a couple of times. School counseling is, this is a generalization, but typically you're working in schools advising students regarding their academics and their career plan, okay? That's typically what school counseling. There is some also social emotional support is offered in that way to students. Clinical counseling, there's a lot of different types of clinical counseling. You could do marriage and family therapy, so you could become really specialized and just work with a particular subgroup of the population. You could do substance abuse counseling, right? And we have some substance abuse counseling related courses in our BA program. You could also just be doing generalized counseling, working with individuals who come in with different problems, and if there's a particular problem that you don't have a specialization with, you can refer them out, right? So there are a lot of different types of counseling. You could do work counseling where you're specifically working with children, specifically working with youth, specifically working with children who have experienced particular kinds of difficulties, like trauma in their lives. So you could become really specialized, right? So there are lots of different types of counseling. Like I said, there's clinical psychology, where you can open up a clinical practice and be working with individuals who are diagnosed with mental illness, right? Mm-hmm. Individuals like who have schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, right? So you could be working with a specialized population in that way. I know a lot of professors who are teaching and who are clinical psychologists with PhDs and they're teaching and they have a research or a clinical practice on the side. Mm-hmm. They're doing both. So if you can't decide, do it all. You can do it all. And it's lucrative, man. I should have gone that way. This way. Dang. All right, so identify passion. We've talked a lot about that. Start thinking about possibilities. You can start thinking about programs. Check this out. Miranda Haskey walked into my office one day, and I swear there was like a light beam on her. She's like, here. And I was like, what? This is a book that has every single graduate program in the United States in the field of psychology as of 2017. She's like, here, somebody gave this to me. You can have it. So if by state, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna photocopy all of Arizona and New Mexico, PDF it and email it out to everybody, okay? I'm gonna also email out all the handouts they're on, so if you take it home and your husband accidentally uses it to start the fire or something like that, you can download it in your email. All right, so I'm gonna send everything out, but I'm gonna have this in my office. I'm gonna leave this here at the end so you can kind of look through it. It doesn't include, I noticed, I was like looking for certain kinds of programs. It doesn't include online programs. And in a minute, I'm gonna ask Dr. Bradway to come up here because he pursued his PhD completely online. And that's a nice option and opportunity for students here, right? Who need to be here with family, is to pursue an online program. And Western New Mexico University is cool. I was looking at their program. I think that they might now be GRE exempt. They don't require, so there are some programs, and you're still like, what is the GRE? There are some programs that don't require it, but most programs do. But a lot of online programs don't. I don't even think I've seen an online program that requires the GRE. And their online programs, when they were first initiated, there was a lot of they had a bad reputation. But now there are some seriously legit online programs, and they're getting a lot of credibility now. Mm-hmm. So you can have a very legitimate graduate degree from an online institution. And for many individuals, it's the way to go, all right? So have dream goals, have a goals, right? And gather information. I'm gonna have this in my office too. Like I said, you can stop by anytime. Most of you know, I'm just there constantly. I think I'm a robot. I don't know. I'm just always there. I seem to never sleep. Levine was saying, when you're in graduate school, you're sleeping only 3 or 4 hours a night. I'm like, am I still in graduate school? I don't know. I woke up early this morning. So connect with people who can help you. Myself, Dr. Bradway, Levine. There are a lot of people. Our door is open. You can come anytime. If you start working on your application materials, we can help you review them. Don't even have to ask me, although you should let me know. But if you're going to ask for a reference from me, yes, okay? The answer is yes. Mm-hmm. It's not a question. Don't be nervous about asking whether I will provide a reference for you. Yes. And when you get to the point where you're asking for references, ask the person, can you provide me with a strong reference? That's different than asking, can you provide me with a reference? Sure. I can talk about you. Can you provide me with a positive and strong reference? And I'm telling you right now, I will provide everybody here with a very strong input. And everybody watching who's in the Psych BA program, if you just accidentally logged on to this YouTube video, once it's posted, it's gonna be posted on YouTube. If you're some creeper in New Jersey or something like that, I'm not promising a reference for you, okay? But if you're in the Psych BA program or you're interested in the Psych BA program, yes, okay. And I know that many of us feel the same way, all right? So connect with people who can help you. I'm one of those people. Yeah. Attend workshops, talk to your undergraduate advisor, which is also me, so just come talk to me, okay? Mm-hmm. Study, ask questions, get related experience, volunteer if you can, okay? It's good. It looks good on your application to volunteer, especially in a field that you want to pursue. Mm-hmm. But that's why we also have in the program, we have built into it an internship opportunity, right? Mm-hmm. So that's also an opportunity for you to get some of that hands-on experience in exchange for course credit, right? So you don't have to feel like you have too much on your plate. And so if you're interested in counseling in particular, pursue an internship. You might want to pursue both. I know students already who are like, I want to do both, the undergraduate research and the internship opportunity. Okay. Yeah, we can do that. Mm-hmm. okay? It's a one more class, but it's all right. It'll look really good on your application for graduate school. Cast a wide net, so I already talked about this, right? And have a backup plan. It doesn't have to be backpacking all over the world, although seriously, that's awesome. But have a backup plan to travel the world just in case. It doesn't have to be to travel the world. And applying to graduate schools is competitive, and there can be an X factor. The X factor does not reflect upon you. The X factor is something to do with the faculty who are choosing the applicants, something to do with just like whoever else applied at that time. I mean, it's like there's some unpredictability to it, okay? So work as hard as you can, cast a wide net, keep trying, just go for it. Just keep going for it, don't stop. Regarding graduate school, family, and culture, I've experienced this. So I used to always say that I'm a first generation college student, and then I just found out, I'm 39 years old, that my grandmother has a master's degree. I just found that out. And I was like, I've been a liar for like the last 2 decades of my life. But I didn't know that. Remember I told you nobody had ever said the term, nobody even ever talked to me about going to college. I guess they just thought that I was like, just like, had no potential. Like, I could have been somebody. So nobody ever talked to me about going to college. And I say this, I've said this before, I was working at McDonald's for a while after I graduated high school, and I got suspended for stealing a chicken McNugget. And then I got into a fight when I was like, is this? And I finally, after a year and a half, I got my first 15 cent raise. Back then, my wage was $4.35 an hour. And suddenly I was like, is this all there is? And so I enrolled in college. Nobody ever talked to me about it. And so in my family, nobody talked about college. My grandmother had a master's degree at a time when women were not pursuing higher education. That's amazing, right? So for me, really, within my family, she's an exception. Nobody talks about it. And nobody looks very favorably upon higher education, not really. And so when I started going to school, one thing I did not predict would happen. I did not predict this. Nobody talked to me about it. And I know I've talked to some of you about it already. You're already experiencing this. My cousins, especially in psychology, man, if you're pursuing psychology, my cousins started distancing themselves from me. And they would like talk to each other, but not to me. And one time I was there and I left and they started talking to my mom and they said, we feel like she's analyzing us. And I was like, oh yeah, because you're so interesting. That interesting. My whole life revolves around thinking about what you're thinking. But just over time, like even though when my grandmother passed away, they were like, well, you write the eulogy, you're the one who's all educated. It started being like that. And you'll get that. And it's funny, like people have a concept of higher education. So first you're like, I'm gonna go to college. Everybody's like, yeah, of course, you should. We absolutely support you. But if you're first generation college, and a lot of times people around you, they might not know what it actually takes to succeed in college. And what does it take? Time and effort, time away from your family. Your family are gonna be asking you to do things, and you're gonna have to say, no, I have to study, I have to write papers, right? And that's when it starts to turn, when the reality hits, right? So, you know, just be really open as you can with your family if you're in that situation. For some of us, like, we're not in that situation. Even in this room, maybe our parents went to college, right? And that's why, I know I talked to a lot of students who, all their older siblings went to college, and that's why they're going to college, right? So, but if you're in this situation, just be sure to be open in communicating and to just say, like, I really want to be with the family, but I have to do this thing. And once I'm done this thing, I can come back. Right? But here's why, then to explain, why are you doing it? Explain it, you know. But sometimes it's bumpy. So there's research, I say this, I talked about this in my Psych 340 class. I'm Bill Ghana. There's research showing that if you ask white people, what is your culture? White people are like, what do you mean? Like, I don't understand the question. So when I talk about being firmly grounded in culture, I'm talking about this from a psychological research perspective. There's research showing that particularly for Native American students, that being grounded in culture and having a strong identity, strong cultural identity is a protective factor. Especially, it actually is associated with higher academic achievement in higher education, all right? So don't pursue this higher education and turn away from culture. Embrace them both, right? And I've said this in the psychology BA program. One thing that's really cool about the fact that we have both a Navajo perspective and a Western perspective is that you guys are the first generation ever mm-hmm. of Diné people to, like I say, my knowledge is like this over here, right? I have one kind of knowledge, and I'm Western, right? And the other faculty who are teaching, they have like a knowledge over here. And there's like a Western and a Diné. You're the first generation who get to pull it all together. Mm-hmm. You're going to determine what Navajo psychology looks like. You are going to invent it. You're creating it. You're already doing it mm-hmm. in your assignments, in your thinking, in your writing, in your everything that you're doing right now, right? So bring it all together. And you're going to be the first generation of Navajo psychologists. You know? That's you. Right now, it already is. Already. Mm-hmm. So bring, you know, really meditate on that. It's take it seriously, you know. And that's why I know like a lot of students are interested in this program. They'll point to like introduction to Navajo psychology and they're like, that's why I'm here, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so find faculty mentors with student support. When you get into graduate school, find a faculty mentor. And then, you know, just because you graduate from Diné College doesn't mean you can't. Like I said, I'm always in my office. Just give me a call, right? Especially, even sometimes you don't even know what you want to say or ask. You just want to vent. I don't know. There's something in graduate school called the imposter complex, the imposter syndrome. This is pervasive and ubiquitous. It affects almost everybody. You get in there, maybe you've had this experience before. You get into something and you look around and you're like, wait, how did I get here? You're like, everybody else, like, they look like they belong here. Like, I feel like I don't belong here. It must be some sort of accident. I don't know how I slipped through the cracks and got in, right? Mm-hmm. You feel like you're an imposter, like you don't really belong there. But guess what? Everybody feels that way. So if you ever have that thought, you're looking around, be like, wait a minute. I see her, and I remember what Sara said. Wait, she's thinking that too. She's looking at me and thinking the same thing. I thought it all the time. Right? A lot of times you just feel like, do I really belong here? How did I get here? Okay? No, you belong. You belong. There's no question about it. But sometimes it can feel a certain way. So if you ever want to vent, you can always contact your previous faculty mentor. Find one in your graduate program. Find student support. Mm-hmm. A graduate degree affords opportunities to give back to the community, opportunities to improve harmful systems, and opportunities to help others who come after you have a smoother path. Sometimes that means you have to kind of like accept the system until you can get inside the system, right? Like, one of the reasons that I'm interested in cultural psychology is because when I was an undergrad, I noticed that it was totally biased towards Western thinking, right? And having growing up in the Western world and experienced a lot of problems, I was like, this is not helping me. This particular Western way of life is not helping me. There must be a better way to be on this earth. There's gotta be something more, something better. And I realized that, I pursued psychology, I thought this will help, but no, it was the same problem in psychology, totally biased. And so what I wanted to do was get into the system and change the system, right? So I often say I'm kind of like the anti-psychology psychologist. I feel like the field of psychology, it needs to grow, it needs to diversify. And so I did look at, I'm here, right? I'm working with like amazing people who are my mentors, who are teaching me. Students who are teaching me. Mm-hmm. I learned from you, you know, this is an exchange. And together we're building a program that's not like every other program. Mm-hmm. This is a special program. We're inside the system, we're changing it, right? So you might have to study for the GRE and we'll hate it, but one day we'll develop our own graduate program and we won't require the GRE. Mm-hmm. Oh. Now I have a vision for, look at, you inspired me. That's what we're going to do here at Diné College. How do you pay for graduate school? Well, it depends. It depends on the graduate program. You might have to take out loans. But here's the thing, even if you have to take out student loans, and different programs cost different amounts of money. Remember, it's a short-term investment for a long-term payoff. One of the things that I told myself when I was in graduate school was, I have to work really hard and do well at this and complete it so that I can get a good job and pay off my crazy debt. I had like $35,000 worth of debt or something like that. And that's nothing compared to some people's debt. Mm-hmm. And so I knew I had to work hard so I could get myself to the point where I could get a job that would earn me enough money to pay off my student debt. And I did. My student debt, I just paid it off finally last year. All right. And I'm on the other side of it now. Freedom! And it feels good. It's not anticlimactic. It is climactic. It was like, yes! So even if you have to take out a loan, it's not the end of the world. No. The job opportunities that you'll be able to pursue with a bachelor degree, with a graduate degree, will help you to pay all of that off, and then some, and then a lot of some, okay? So for full-time students, in many programs are often graduate student assistantship. Now, what does this book tell you? This book tells you what the admission requirements are, what the acceptance and rejection rates are, what the number of applications that they received, whether they provide graduate assistantships. Sometimes they'll provide you with a stipend, and then you can like be a teacher assistant. You might have heard that term before, a TA in a class for a faculty. You might teach a lab component of a course, or help the faculty member to grade papers, right? Or hold study sessions in exchange for a pretty decent, I think it's still below the poverty line. They don't pay graduate students a lot, but you know, you can survive. You can put food on the table, all right? A lot of times programs will provide tuition waivers, and again, this tells you which programs do that. It'll tell you, if you're accepted, you'll get a tuition waiver. In other words, you don't have to pay anything, and they'll provide you with a graduate assistantship or a teaching assistantship, okay? This book just has a lot of information about every single kind of program that's offered. It tells you whether the GRE is required or not, what the average GRE scores are for individuals who are accepted into the program, what the cost is, whether students took out student loans, what the average debt is, things like that. Yeah, so this is a good book. It's like, I know. For a minute, I thought I lost it. I was like, what did I do with it? Oh, God, I just love it.
Jerry burned it.
For real.
He built the fire with it.
Keep it away from you. All right. And then federal student loans. At the graduate level, for most federal student loans, they start charging interest right away. For a lot of master's program, we have like an expert from financial aid, so he might be able to provide a little bit more information. But even if you take out loans, if you end up working for the Navajo Nation, for example, like right now, the work that I'm doing is considered a public service kind of a job, right? Whether I'm actually providing a public service or not is up to somebody else, but that's what the job is categorized. So if I took out a student loan right now, I could work here for 10 years. I could pay a very low monthly payment, and after 10 years, the entire rest of my loan is forgiven. So there are like loan forgiveness opportunities, right? There are also a lot of scholarships, especially for Native students, right? And this is something that we should start working on, is like finding graduate school scholarships. Okay, look at all the to-do lists I have just from giving this presentation. Create a graduate program that doesn't require GRE, find scholarship opportunities for graduate school, but there's a lot, right? And you just have to, again, put the work into it in order to research that. So if you've done your research well, the payoffs from the salary increase and the increased job satisfaction makes it well worth it. There's not a second that I regret it. You know, for a long time I was still struggling financially while I was trying to pay off my student loans. I still don't regret it. Not at all. So finding the right program, there are a lot of programs in New Mexico, and even like, for example, Western New Mexico University is in Gallup, that's pretty close. There are a lot of online programs. So just consider like, where do you want to be? What do you want to pursue? What kind of program is it? If it's a PhD, in a lot of cases, the PhD program is not online, but there are online programs available, and Dr. Bradway completed that. Did you want to say a couple words about online? Is there anything
do I have to go up there, or can I sit?
You can stay there.
Okay, thanks.
Nobody can see you.
The PhD program, the graduate programs online are the same. They're actually the same classes. And we're doing exactly the same thing. I'm teaching abnormal psychology in the classroom and online at the same time. Right. So in essence, it's exactly the same thing.
Right.
But their programs are very similar to that. My experience, of course, with graduate school completely different from Sarah's because, mainly because I was in the military at the time, and when you're in the military, you work 24/7. So I had to find time, I had to actually find time to be able to work. I was working in the hospital at the time, on call and whatnot, and they'd call me out at horrible times. nobody ever has a baby at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, or 10 o'clock in the morning. It's always at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. And everybody has a diabetic crisis at what time? 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning. Anyway, so my experiences were completely different. I did finish my PhD online. It took me a while. The biggest problem that I had was because we were in the military, we weren't stable enough to be able to, I wasn't stable enough to start a program anywhere. So I had to do everything online. But there are very good programs. The information that I have is very similar to, I'm a general psychologist and Sara, of course, is a cognitive psychologist. But the information that I received is very similar to what she received. So it all depends on how much effort you put into it as to what you get out of it. So there you go.
Thank you.
You are.
And really what your needs are, right? So you can see like the different circumstances affecting the decisions we make about what kinds of programs we pursue. So here's some additional information. This is on your handout about finding the right program. I've talked a little bit now about different types of programs. A Master of Arts in counseling, okay, versus a Master of Social Work. Mm-hmm. What's the difference between counseling and social work? They're just slightly different kinds of jobs. Mm-hmm. And I really encourage you to look that. There are some good Master of Social Work programs. There's one at Western New Mexico University, but I just looked online. I was doing some research as I was preparing for this workshop, and they've closed applications right now for students who are getting bachelor degrees from other institutions because they've already like met their quota for what they can provide. And most Master of Social Work programs accept Bachelor of Psychology as a foundation, mm-hmm. but not at Western New Mexico University. They only accept a Bachelor of Social Work. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And from their school. They only accept students who get a Bachelor of Social Work from their school. But there's an online Master of Social Work program at ASU. They accept Bachelor of Psychology. It's all online. And the GRE is waived. Look, I was looking at the GRE. I was like, when can they not have to do a GRE? The GRE is waived if your junior senior GPA is 3.2 or higher for that program. Yeah. So that's an opportunity. And like I said, you know, do this research. Google it. What can you do with a master's in social work? There are different kinds of things. Google it. That's how I found the programs that I applied to when I applied. They even had Google way back then. I think Google's like brand new. And I Googled it. I Googled like culture and cognitive psychology. And like all these people popped up. So when you apply to graduate school, I say all these people popped up. You usually want to identify a couple people who you might want to work with in those programs. What are they doing? Because you're going to be assigned a faculty mentor, and they're going to teach you how to do what they're doing. So you want to find the right match. And then you want to contact those people, and you're going to be like, what? They're so busy. They don't have the time of day for me. No, they do. They're used to this. Don't be, you know, you're going to be their colleague one day, right? So feel free to approach them and just ask the question. Say, I'm really interested in the work you're doing. I really want to pursue that kind of work. Are you accepting graduate students for the upcoming academic year, right? And they usually start looking at applications in spring for the upcoming fall. So application deadlines are usually like December. That's why I'm offering this workshop now. If you know that you're going to graduate in May 2018, and some of you are on track to do that, and some of you got more time, but if you know that you're on track to graduate in May 2018, you want to start thinking about graduate schools now if you feel like that's something you want to pursue after. And you start studying for the GRE now because you're going to be submitting applications in the fall. And you're not going to find out till the spring. So you want to find some people you might want to work with. Are you accepting students? That's like the X factor. Sometimes the faculty doesn't have any more room for students in their research group or in their mentor group, and so they're not accepting students next year. You didn't know that and you applied to work with this person and they're like, sorry, I'm not accepting the students. Do you see what I mean? So reach out to them, and if you're a little nervous about how to do that, come hang out at my office and we'll reach out together, all right? It'll still be from you, but I'll help you craft that email. I know that whole game. In my previous job, I was on the graduate student selection committee. I helped to decide which students were going to be accepted into our graduate program. And I mentored students, I had a research lab, it was all legit. So I know it, okay? I know what I'm doing, I know how to help get there. Versus a PhD, you know, if you want to do counseling and clinical psychology, either of these are okay. If you want to do research, this is the way to go, all right? So sometimes you might want to think about research, but on the Navajo Nation, there'll be more jobs available for counseling and social work, I think, than for research.
Site D?
Site D.
Site D.
Yeah, that one I never really got a handle on.
Doctorate in psychology. Yes, some programs have.
It's like a kind of clinical psychology.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's a kind of clinical psychology.
Right.
Google it. All right. Yeah.
As far as how many, for the master's, is it a year?
It depends on the program. It's usually 2 years. So a master's program is on average 2 years. Sometimes it can take 3, you know, but that's like, it's like a bachelor's degree is on average 4 years, but it can take 5 or 6 or 7, right?
So if it were 2 years, you would have to have a good course load every semester.
Yes. And usually the way that it works in graduate school, and by the way, PhD is usually on average 5 years, okay? So that's the comparison. Most PhD programs have a master's program built into it, so you earn your master's along the way. I did a master's program that was part of a PhD, decided I wanted to do something different, ditch that, and apply for something else. So even if you get on the wrong track, you can switch, right? But the way the graduate programs work is it's usually like real heavy coursework in the beginning and then a lot of internship on the second half. So the front half is usually a lot of coursework and training and classroom training, and then it transitions into a lot of hands-on applied work. In the case of counseling, it's a lot of internships. So you heard about like hours of internship. So that's the second like the second year of a master's program in counseling. And for PhD, same thing. Real heavy coursework in the beginning. Though my last 2 years, I didn't take any courses. It was all like hands-on applied research. My dissertation, you know? So master's thesis, dissertation. So this is like your specialization. What are you going to become an expert about? Right? And you usually, and this is, it's, what's cool about it compared to a bachelor is that you start developing a level of expertise where you get to be really creative, right? You know what's been done. And so now you get to start asking new questions. And you have the skills to be able to do that. It's pretty cool. It's actually really fun. It's hard, but really, really fun and empowering, you know? Then you feel like, so you can hear it even. For people who have graduate degrees, they feel empowered to be able to ask questions about what's going on here, right?
So and that's what. I think what, to answer your question too, is that, you know, here at the BA program, we're saying, you know, 12 to 15 credit hours, right?
Right.
At the graduate level, you're looking at 9 is considered full-time.
Yeah.
But heavy courses.
Yeah, heavy course, yes.
Yeah.
And a lot of research, yeah. A lot of writing. You know, here at the BA level, we may require 3 to 7 page research paper, right? At the graduate level, you're looking at 10, 15, even 20.
Yeah. Okay. And my dissertation was like 140 pages or something like that. And that's short compared to some. Christine wrote like a whole book in anthropology, man. Just be happier in psychology. I watched her going around like, she's like, how did you organize your chapters? I was like, that's an anthropology thing. So, but, and then the master's thesis can be like anywhere between 50 and 100 pages or longer. I don't know. It depends on the program.
Going back to the clinical too, it's not only the thesis, but it's a portfolio.
Yeah.
And you have, out of that, you may have 6 competency levels that you have to defend. You have all your, at the end of your program, you have 6 professors sitting there. And you have to take 3 of your 6 clinical, and you have to defend that.
It's called the defense. You might have heard that, right? I don't know if you've heard that.
It's very intimidating.
It's called the defense, and you feel like you're defending. But you're not defending yourself. And actually, this is what's important. So kind of like calm anxieties about it. What you've done is that you've been working really hard, and you've put a lot of work into something. And now you're at the point where you're becoming a colleague. So you put all the work up there. And you kind of, this is the way that it was explained to me. It really helped me when I went into my dissertation. Now you're sitting back with colleagues who are still your mentors because they have a lot more experience than you do. But you're at that point where you're crossing that threshold. And now as a group of colleagues, you're looking at the work that you've put together, often together, in partnership, and you're saying, okay, like, what do we think? And you learn how to think critically about it. In my Psych 340 class, I spent a lot of the first class talking about thinking critically. So in our BA program, we're already prepping students for that. A lot of the classes are very cool. They're very seminar style. You do a lot of like readings and then come together and take turns presenting and sharing ideas, just like Psych 340. That's why I'm organizing the class like that, so that that's very, you're like, no problems when you get to graduate school. You're familiar with that style. And it's very, a lot of critical thinking. A lot. In fact, it's very valuable. Sometimes it gets competitive, like who can be the most critical in their thinking. It's kind of weird, actually. It gets into a real weird space, but that's graduate school for you. So I have a lot of handouts, and I asked everybody, and if you haven't got them yet, they're on that table, and for all of you watching through video here, I'm going to send them all out in an email, and we're going to try to post them to our SBS webpage. But in addition to the handout of this presentation, that doesn't include some of the inappropriate jokes. So you want to go to graduate school, a track to run on. Right now, in your junior and senior year, what are steps that you need to be taking and thinking about, right? Especially if you're on track to graduate in May 2018. This is something you want to read, okay, and think about. The grad school decision, basic considerations. Just another handout to get you thinking about why you want to pursue graduate school, whether it's right for you. And if you're not sure whether it's right for you, then it's right for you. If you absolutely know that you don't want to go, then don't go. But if you're like, I think I could, I don't know, then you should go, okay? That's the place, that's the space where you're like considering the possibility, go for it. If you can, if you want to, if your family supports it, all right? If you find the right graduate program, if you get accepted, then absolutely. Okay, grad school decision, going back. You know, a lot of us were already in college, so this is kind of for people who have taken a break, but a lot of us, there is an increasing number of mature students who are like raising a family and working and then coming back to school. So this applies even if you're in college right now, to be thinking about what it's like, you know, to be coming back. You're just right now kind of re-immersing yourself into like educational culture. So then how does that apply to graduate school? Okay, what does it take to get into a program? So some of these other handouts. The application process. So I mentioned some of these handouts. Academic aptitude, the GPA and the GRE. This also said MAT, the LSAT, the MCAT. That's like if you want to become a lawyer, all right? But most of us, like in psychology behavior, we're going to pursue something that's more like social behavioral sciences related. Mm-hmm. And all of those are GRE, okay? Relevant life experience. Short-term and long-term goals, self-awareness. This is what admissions committees are looking for. How in the world can they find, if this is what they're looking for, where do they find it? In your personal statement. In your personal statement. That's where you're writing about why you want to pursue graduate school, why you want to pursue this graduate program, why you want to work with these individuals, what you hope to accomplish with your graduate degree. And there's handouts here, tips for writing an effective personal statement. And like I said, you know, some of us, we are like used to personal statements. We can help you review those. We can help you write those. That's what we're here for. Related work experience. It could be paid or volunteer. It's not always easy to find like a paid job, especially if you're still in your bachelor degree program. I'm going to get back to GRE. Yeah.
Volunteer work. What are most graduate schools looking at as far as hours per week?
You know what they want to see? Oh, as far as hours? So for myself, I graduated once per week, I wish. I volunteered once a week on Wednesday evenings, and that was sufficient. I also had a lot of research experience, but that was like through the coursework that I was doing in my program. So maybe like once a week or once every couple of weeks. I don't think it's really hours that, at least in my experience, it's not really hours they're looking at, it's like the type of volunteer work you're doing. Mm-hmm. They want to see that you have the kind of experience that is a match for, because, you know, put yourself in their shoes, right? They are bringing on somebody who they're going to mentor. They want to mentor somebody who's like excited and interested in the same things that they are, mm-hmm. right? So that's what I mean, like look around and see what programs are offering, what kinds of programs, what faculty are doing. And then look for volunteer opportunities that might be related to that in some way. You know, you might not find the exact same thing, but it can be just in the case of volunteers, almost in roughly in the domain. Okay, yeah.
I think one of the things for me was volunteering with the women's shelter, and that was one that I did in my undergrad when I was in Las Cruces.
Wow.
Yeah, and then coming back here, we had the women's shelter in Chinle, and that's one place where, you know, you volunteer as well too, where we have families that need like overnight stay, and you open your home to them, especially when there's little children involved.
Wow.
Yeah, so you can be on call for that.
Yeah.
What have you done field experience, like social work? Because I've done that too with the women's shelter.
Cool.
Would that count?
That's great. That counts, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep, that counts.
They want to know that you understand what you're getting into.
Okay.
So if you volunteered someplace where you've actually dealt with this, then now you know. Now you know exactly what you want.
It's not going to be a shock to you, and you're not going to suddenly be like, what? I can't handle this.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's a great way to put it. Are there any other questions about that part? And again, just start thinking about it. If you continue to have more questions, this is not the only time to ask questions, right? And the video people, contact me, okay? Or Levine, or Dr. Bradley.
Oh, you.
Off the tell, this is like a student group. This is less important. Papers presented, publications. We're going to have opportunities to work on some of these things in the research components of the psychology BA program. Right now, tomorrow, like as soon as this is over, I'm hitting the road. I'm driving to Twin Arrows to go to a board, their board member, the board, I'm being video recorded, our esteemed board are holding their board meeting tomorrow at Twin Arrows. Of course. And I'm required to go to the board meeting because what I'm doing there is that I'm presenting a memorandum of agreement and a resolution related to getting our institutional review board up and running here at Diné College, which is the review board that will enable research to take place here at Diné College. And in particular, you know, in a research methods class, I say we don't have IRB approval, so we can't share our findings outside of this classroom experience. Once we have our institutional IRB, we can pursue publication. So we're getting that on track this semester. And tomorrow I'm going to be at the board presenting that to the board for approval. And then we're going to take it to the Navajo Nation and to the Navajo Nation Research Review Board. So this is happening, all right? So this is possible. It is in your future. And even in the case of counseling, I met with the chair of the counseling program at NAU as I was preparing for this workshop. They look for students, even though it's counseling and it feels like it's very different from research, they're looking for students with research experience for a couple of reasons. One is it enables you to be a critical thinker, which is what they want. But also, if you have research experience, that means you have experience understanding research, right? A lot of the work that you're going to do is going to be informed by theories that are based on research, informed by practices that are based on research findings. And you need to be able to consume that research in a way that's like critical and helps you to decide which kinds of practices are most effective for the particular client that you're working with, right? So they value research even in counseling programs. So this is good. Even if you're like, it's not your, I know for some students they're like, that's what I want to do. I've had some students say that. I'm like, yes. But even if you feel like it's not the thing for you, it still is something the graduate programs are looking for, and it's built into our program, so you don't feel like you have to take it on above and beyond the program, okay? Letters of recommendation, usually three, at least two from professors who you've worked with. Make sure you ask for strong recommendations. And already for us, the answer is yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Strong recommendations, no problem. In fact, it's my pleasure. I love writing letters of recommendation. I can just go on and on. And they like the letters of recommendation to be detailed. Mm-hmm. So when you're asking for letters of recommendation, it's helpful. You want to help your letter writer. So you want to provide them with some details. How long you've been working with that faculty member, right? Remind the faculty member when you first met them, how many classes you've taken with them. Maybe like some accomplishments that you had over the course of working with that faculty member. What your current GPA is, what your interests are, what your goals are. Don't make it too long because a lot of times faculty are really busy, but just like a short synopsis, just to remind them. And also give them a little bit of a description. What program are you applying to? And give them a list. What are all the programs, because you're going to cast a wide net. All the programs and their deadlines and how the letters need to be submitted. For some programs, they need to be submitted online. For other programs, they need to be snail mailed. All right, we still do that. And so it really depends on the program, and you need to provide all that information to the faculty member and give your faculty member or your letter writer at least 2 weeks notice to be able to write that letter and get it submitted. I will, if you panic and you leave it to the last minute, and you ask me at the last minute, I will do it at the last minute.
So
don't be like, oh, it's not 2 weeks, and she said 2 weeks, and no, I will still write it. But 2 weeks is good, it's nice. goodness of fit for the program. They want to see, we've already talked about that, writing ability, which you're going to demonstrate in your personal statement, and also through your GPA, right? That's an indicator, a reflection of you. Okay, so what is the GRE? This is the moment we've all been waiting for, right? What is the GRE? So you can't really see this, but there's a bunch of old white guys, like presidents, like Ronald Reagan and Bush, and they're just like laughing their asses off. And here's what the meme says. And then I created the GRE and said it was a fair standardized testing measurement. And they bought it, because guess what? It's not a fair standardized testing measurement. And yet, so it's culturally biased, and so many programs rely on it. I think the reason that, and I hate the GRE, I hate it. It doesn't predict graduate student success very well. And I think the reason that programs still rely on it is that, especially increasingly, we're getting more and more applications. It's really, really difficult to decide which applications you should look at and which applications you should not look at. And so a lot of times they'll use the GRE to just quickly categorize, and they'll look at applications that meet a certain GRE cutoff. So, and that's like ridiculous. Yeah, that's not a good system. And then there are other individuals who believe that the GRE actually predicts something when it doesn't, right? So there's research, because I'm a researcher, I look at the research on this, showing that the best predictor of graduate school success is, can you guess? Motivation. Mm-hmm. Motivation. That's why I say passion is everything, it's motivation. That's the best predictor of graduate student success, because that's going to motivate you to work really, really, really hard, and it's going to keep you going at 3 in the morning. When everybody else is sleeping and you're still writing, trying to finish that 10-page paper. So the reason why the GRE is so biased is it's just very standardized. When I took it, I was in Canada. We don't even have SATs in Canada. There's like no standardized testing there. So I thought it was just like an intelligence test. And I was like, well, either I'm smart or I'm not smart. I didn't study for it at all. And I totally bombed the first time, like bombed, like bad. I was like, what? So then I did some research into it. It turns out you should study for this particular examination. And you know what it was? There's like a verbal section. They've modified it, and they've made it, it's different compared to when I took it. But there's, I think now there's 2 math sections, 2 verbal sections, and an analytical section. Mm-hmm. And the math is like math that you've forgotten about, that you took like back in 1993, okay? This is like old school, like grade 7 math that I didn't remember. I was like, and if you're in my staff class, you saw my math history, right? I went through that. If you're in that class, yeah, there's a couple people in that class. So I bombed the math section. The verbal section is very like abstract. And so you have to do a lot of like analogy. So not just knowing the words and their definitions, but understanding how they relate to each other, how to create analogies and metaphors. It's very abstract and bizarre. And then there's an analytical section, which is like, you know, if so-and-so leaves at such and such time. I mean, this is like these kind of crazy puzzles. So the way to do good, to do well at the GRE is to practice for the GRE. And you know what the GRE measures? It measures how good you are at taking the GRE. And that's it, all right? And it's like this necessary evil. I tell the story. This is a quick story, but it's a enlightening story. When I applied to my PhD program, I told you I had a 4.0 GPA in my master's degree program, right? I had several publications, a ton of experience. I had been working as a research assistant, so a lot of research experience. My high GPA was in a graduate program. So what's a better predictor of graduate school success than previous graduate school success? And I told you that I applied to a lot of programs, and my GRE scores were okay, because I took it a second time after I got some tutoring. I did. I needed to hire a math tutor. And I memorized, I got GRE practice books, and I have tips for that. And I practiced and practiced and practiced. I memorized words and definitions. And so I did okay. It wasn't like amazing. Everything else was amazing, and I was like, okay. So I got into some programs and not others. That's why I didn't get into as many programs. I had a friend who I ended up in graduate school with. His GPA was like okay. It was okay. It was like average. He had no research experience, no publications, nothing. He had no previous graduate school experience. He studied for the GRE for 2 years. For 2 years he studied for that dang thing, which is like, I don't even know how you could tolerate that. And he got like the highest percentile in statistics. We learn about percentiles, like the highest percentile you could get, like 99th percentile or something like that, and like almost the very highest. And he got accepted into every single school that he applied for, and he applied for all the big ones, all the top ones. And he got it, he had his choice. Okay, so that's the GRE. This isn't to scare you, it's just the reality, all right? If you have a high GRE, and it depends on the program, right? So we heard like, in some cases, the letters of recommendation, schools weigh those more. But like at Western New Mexico University, they just like got rid of the GRE. And those are programs that really care about students. Now all programs really care about students, but this is kind of like this movement that's happening. When I was applying, all of the programs required GREs. Increasingly, more and more programs are not requiring GREs. So there's like an awakening, okay? What are we using? What is this crazy thing that we've been doing for the last several decades? Just need to wake up. So how can you prepare for the GRE? And you're not gonna like some of these suggestions. Some of them you're gonna be like, are you serious? And yeah, unfortunately I am. Now this is like the cheap way to go. This is what I did. I bought some GRE prep books. You can do this. I hired a math tutor. It was like my friend. I don't even think I paid him anything. I think I bought him like a box of chicken McNuggets or something like that. And he helped me. And my math scores really improved a lot. It was like reminding myself of like whatever, grade 7 math we were doing. Here's a link to the GRE. These are like particular books. I did a research like and looked at all the reviews, the best books that you can use to practice. And just like when you get a bit of free time, right, with all of your extra free time, log on to Amazon, get one of these books, and just start practicing. Like, if you can get yourself to practice a little bit every day, 10 minutes a day, all right? It's kind of hard, and you have to, like, really self-discipline. Just practice a little bit every day. That's what it is. It's just practice. That's it. It's not impossible to understand material. It's not difficult material. It's not measuring your IQ. It's just measuring. It's measuring how good you are at the kinds of questions it asks, and the way to get better at that is to just practice. So this is the link to the GRE for more. They have some tools on there, some free tools actually, support tools. This is a link to GRE prep materials on the GRE website, and this is a link to GRE test centers. You have to go, you have to make an appointment, you have to go in, you have to pay money, of course, and the next slide is like cash cow. This is an industry. Why do we still have the GRE? It's an industry. And so you have to make an appointment. There's a GRE test center in Farmington. Mm-hmm. I checked recently. All of their appointment slots are open and available. So it's not like a mad rush to go in and take your GRE in Farmington, New Mexico, okay? So you have like lots of opportunities to get in there. So when I went to NAU and met with the chair there, what they were saying to me was, for students that get accepted into their program, what they really recommend, and they recommend it, and they said I should recommend it to you, so I'm recommending it to you, if you want to get into an NAU program, they have good programs there, is a GRE prep course. There's such a thing. They have online prep courses. They also have like live streaming prep course. They're horrible. They're really good. They prepare you. Why are they horrible? They are ridiculously, insanely, unethically, inhumanely. Yeah. And if somebody from GRE is watching this, you heard me. Expensive. Okay? Expensive. Mm-hmm. So like Kaplan, the CAP test, which is reviewed and rated as one of the best, the self-paced one online starts at $699. This is what I, right? Live online, $1,000. The cheaper ones that are considered more cost-effective, like this is what it said on the, it's like more cost-effective for people who can't afford these ones, $400 to $800. I mean, come on. Now look it, I did not take a GRE prep course. That friend I was telling you about, he didn't take a GRE prep course. He bought books and he practiced. For me, I also hired a tutor for the math, all right? You might want to think about that. If math is not your strong area, it was not my strong area. Yes, I teach stats and it wasn't my strong area, but that's because I kept practicing and practicing stats. But stats as it applies to psychology is different than seventh grade math. It is, I don't know why we had to learn that seventh grade math, but I won't go down that direction on film. So one-on-one tutoring, through this organization, $2,500. Now I'm not showing you this one to suggest it to you. I'm showing this one to you to demonstrate this and to give you an understanding of why the GRE is still used, right? It's an industry. Just like, why are textbooks $275? Right? This is what this Western society is about. So pursue some tutoring with some folks you know who are good at math. Buy them some chicken McNugget. The school that I got into is a really good school. It's Northwestern University. It's one of the top institutions. My graduate school education was amazing. My advisor was the president of the Association for Psychological Science, and he was inducted into the National Academy of Science, okay? This is somebody who didn't practice for the GRE the first time around. I'll be honest with you, I don't want to tell you this because I don't want to encourage you, but the second time I only studied for about 2 weeks, all right? You should study for way more than that. My scores were still not great. There were some schools that didn't even consider my application, okay? I lucked out because this faculty member saw something in me. It was an X factor. He saw a match, and it was a great match. It was a great match. It's why I'm here. It's because of him. It's why I'm here. So study for a little, but I still needed a certain cutoff, and I got there, all right? I think I only have a couple more slides. And then I know it's been like kind of a long, I told you I was gonna like just pump as much information into you as I could, right? So if you walk out of here like, what? Don't even think about it. Walk out of here tonight and just go home, make yourself a hot chocolate. It's all in there, okay? Just like let your body absorb it for the next couple of days. So what if I'm not strong in all areas? I just want to give you a couple of other tips, because we're not all strong in all of these areas, right? Mm-hmm. There are a couple of things that they look for. One really easy one is to join a professional association. As a student, you can get great student rates, mm-hmm. become a student member. They look for these things. Become a student member of APA. I've got some prices. Where do I have prices? Wait, how much longer is my presentation?
Oh, goodness.
I know, right? What the heck? Somewhere I put prices, and then I guess I deleted it. But I'll send out prices and links. It's like anywhere from $30 to $50 a year to be a member of APA. There's one really good one. It's called SIPS. It's a Society for Personality and Social Psychology. That's a really good one, a really well-known one. NAU looks out for that one. I'll send out that information. I deleted it from my slides, I guess, because at some point I thought I had too many slides. But. APA membership, student undergraduate membership, that's a really good one to have. And APS also, I think that one's $35. Have someone proofread your writing, okay, like me or Dr. Bradway. Ask for strong recommendation letters. Research the different faculty who you might be working with. Reach out and contact them. That's the best thing you can do. Remember I told you I found a good match? That's because I reached out to him in advance. And I said, the field of psychology is like crazy. It's so biased. And he was like, agreed, you should come work with me. I was like, done. And that was, then I had to apply. Then I had to go out there and interview. Sometimes for some programs you apply, and if your application is selected for an interview, you have to go travel out there. A lot of times, a lot of programs, if they do that, they'll fund your travel out there. They select you for interviews. You'll go interview, sometimes for a couple days, depending on the program. You'll meet many different faculty and many different students, and you'll go home and then you find out what happened. It depends on the program. That's how some PhD programs operate. Get help from a professor you trust. Meet your deadlines. Nothing will be accepted after the deadline. That's one of the reasons why we emphasize deadlines in college, because you know there are lots of places where if you miss the deadline or you miss this one requirement, they get so many applications, they won't even consider yours. They're trying to weed through it. That's why do these little kind of formatting instructions matter? That's why. Because that's what, when you're applying for a graduate school or for grants, if you don't meet those requirements, they'll toss them. So you gotta learn those skills now, how to follow these detailed instructions. Read and answer questions accurately. Ask for strong recommendations. Have I written this like about 5 times in this presentation? Do you get it? That's like the only thing you're gonna walk out of here remembering. The GRE is like unethical cash cow, and then you should ask for strong recommendations. And start with recommendations as soon as possible. You can get going on that really early. I already talked about this. Make sure recommenders know the deadlines. Here's some information you can provide to them. So that's all in your PowerPoint slides. I went over that. Many programs have an online application process where you can log in and track the completeness of your application file. some I think all programs have an online application process now. I can't even think of programs that wouldn't. No matter how good of a writer you think you are, sometimes you'll write something and you're like, that is good. All right, still have somebody look at it. Somebody will be like, wait, what are you talking about? Yeah, you might have that experience. A lot of times they'll say, if you write a sentence and you think it's like the best sentence you've ever written, you should probably delete it. I've heard that advice. Because sometimes you're like looking at it and you think it's something amazing and you think it's communicating something. You think it's communicating more than it actually is communicating. In your head, it looks amazing. From the reader's perspective, it's like, what are they getting at here? All right. Do not list current personal problems. So sometimes if you want to communicate, like in a personal statement, what you're passionate about, you can refer, a lot of times it's for personal reasons, so you can refer to that, but don't spend a lot of time dwelling on personal problems. Just kind of like refer to it and then talk about what you're going to do to make a difference in a community. Okay, kind of really quickly pivot to that way. But yeah.
Going back to your recommendations, would it be okay to get a recommendation from someone, like say a high school teacher who really influenced you?
Yes.
Knows you well.
Mm-hmm. As long as that's just like one of the three. You really want two of them to be college professors, mm-hmm. And then the other one could be an employer, or no family members. Okay, so you can be related by clan, but not like your brother, blood brother, blood sister. Yeah, so a high school teacher would be fine. Mm-hmm. As long as two of them should really be professors in higher education.
They like PhD behind people's names.
They really like PhD.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. A lot. Yeah. That's what they consider to be legit. If it says write an essay up to a page, write a page or only one or two lines shorter. If it's the limit's a page. If they say 2 pages, don't write half a page, write 2 pages, okay? Or just a little bit less than 2 pages. You really want to try to hit that limit. Look through professor's vita. So have you heard of that word before? Vita or curriculum vita, or you might have heard the word CV. It's like the academic version of a resume. So most faculty, if you want to find out, how can I find out about faculty? Go to the program, go to the institution, go to their department, you'll see a list of faculty, and they'll have a description of themselves, and at most places, not at Diné College for some reason, I brought it up once and it was like, not gonna happen, but at most institutions, there's a link there to their, what's called their CV, the vita, okay? Which is like the academics version of a resume. All the academic positions they've held, their educational background, and you're gonna need to create one for your application too. And in the educational career planning course that we're offering in the fall, we're going to be developing our own curriculum vita, okay? We're going to be creating applications. If you're applying, we'll do that in that class, okay? If you're not applying yet, you're going to get practice doing that, developing and creating personal statements. So that's going to be offered every fall. And the reason why we're holding this workshop is because we don't have it this year for our newest cohort. So I wanted to give you as much information as I could now so you could start thinking about it. If you have to do anything, this is the last slide, so make sure you look at the program of study and look up the classes and the online graduate catalogs so you can relate your personal statement to the kinds of things that they teach and the kinds of interests that the faculty have. But if you're wondering, okay, if you're thinking like, okay, I know I want to do graduate school, and you're wondering, what are my next steps? GRE. Okay, that's like your first step. Start practicing the GRE. You don't have to take it right away. You can take it like in the end of summer, beginning of fall. But start practicing, start looking into it. What is it? What does it look like? You can't know until you start practicing. And if you start practicing now, a little bit at a time, it won't be intimidating. It's really not. I hope I didn't create a lot of anxiety in you by overemphasizing, yeah, a little bit. I hope it's enough. You know, stress is not inherently a bad thing. There's something called eustress. E-U-S-T-R-E-S-S. I teach about this. It's the good kind of stress that motivates you. Like, just before an exam, and you start feeling stressed out, and you're like, I better study. Yeah. So I hope I created that much stress so that you're motivated, but not overwhelmed. You can do the, if I can do the GRE, you can do the GRE, trust me. Like, I'm not good at those things. I'm not good at those things. And then, so look into the GRE, start exploring programs. Start thinking about what you want to do. And just make it a creative break. The only real work that you need to do immediately if you know that you want to apply in the fall is the GRE. Otherwise, just start brainstorming, okay? make it a creative and a fun process. And I want to bring it back, I want to end by bringing it back to the first point. Just make sure you're passionate about it, so that even when you're studying for the GRE, right, there are a lot of things about my work that are like tedious and kind of boring and like just a lot of work. But I, again, I know why I'm here. So I can always remind myself, like, you know, I have to do this for the next 3 hours, it's already midnight. But that's okay, I know why I'm doing it. When you're studying for the GRE, if you know, if you're passionate about what you're looking for, what you want to do with your life, that will get, always just remind yourself. If you get frustrated, stressed out, anxious, just remind yourself. Remind yourself of the vision that you have for yourself in the future, okay? That's where you're going. That's what it's all about, okay? So just be creative about creating that for yourself. All right. Are there any 7:52? You guys did a great, and like nobody really fell asleep for that whole time. It's like Thursday, except for him and my husband. But are there any questions that haven't been answered yet at all? Or there's some. I have a couple of other handouts that you've picked up. Writing your statements and practical advice. There's a lot of information on here about writing personal statements. And the other. The last announcement I want to make is this, the NET to NAU program, it was the last handout on that table. I'm going to send an email out to all the students who couldn't be here. The deadline is the beginning of February. It's free. You get to register as an NAU student. You'll be simultaneously, this is because of our memorandum of agreement that the NET College has with NAU, you get to simultaneously identify as a Diné College student and an NAU student. And when you register, you get to access their resources. So if you're a Flagstaff, you can go hang out in their pool. But they have amazing online library resources. Like amazing. Like blow your mind compared to Diné College. And so if you're interested in exploring a particular topic, you know, register with the Diné to NAU. These are instructions about how to do it. They have a couple, it's like a rolling kind of process, but they have a couple deadlines, like one in the spring, one in the fall. The deadline for spring is the beginning sometime like February 11th?
It's like February 1st.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah, it is, February 1st. If you don't make it now, the next deadline is September 1st, all right? So it's not like this is the only chance, but it is pretty cool to get to be an NAU student and a Diné College student at the same time, right? Okay, yeah, have a great night, everybody. Thank you so much.
Yeah.